So poor Provenza also studied philosophy, like me. But he said it wasn't funny enough. It wasn't funny enough for him. And I'm kind of the same. Like, I mean, I love philosophy. I love it. And I'm pretty good at it too. But sometimes I just feel like singing, you know? I just feel like bursting into song. Like this, I'm like this guy. So when I'm walking down the street, just comes out. It's just got to come out. And so, I mean, imagine if I did that, say it in analytical psychology conference. I also really like analytical psychology. Imagine if I just burst into song in the conference. I mean, you can't do that. You've got to find your place in the world. And my place appears to be hanging out with this guy. He's in his own world. I'm in my own world. We're just hanging out together in our own worlds. What's really interesting, though, I mean, of the legion of interesting things that has been happening with me and this guy, one of the things is that, I mean, I've just kind of ended up being, I've ended up making films, right, and telling stories. And these two things I could not have foreseen because I'm this type of artist that I'm such an organic artist that I do whatever I feel like at any time, you know? Like I'm not a planned guy like he is. So I just let things kind of evolve naturally as they may. And I've ended up making films and telling stories. And, you know, and these are the two things that he really wanted to do. He probably wanted to do other things too, but I know for a fact that he loved film and he really wanted to, really, he spoke about film very early on even. When he was quite young. And of course he'd always been a visual artist as well and always loved art. But he really wanted to make films. And now I'm doing that. And I was not expecting to end up making films, but here I am. I mean, and telling stories. I know for a fact that he would have loved to tell stories and take people on, you know, these fantastic journeys of pure imagination and transport them. You know, he really liked, he's a conjurer, he's a magician. He loves to transport people and be transported himself by others. So I find that quite fascinating that I've ended up doing these two exact things that he wanted to do. I mean, what's that all about? This is 97. 97 was a pivotal year for me because that's when I discovered Jimi Hendrix and Cream. That's when I discovered that I could sing because I was first listened to Billie Holiday. And I was actually in Europe when he was doing this tour, just in a nearby city. Man, had I but known that this guy, this twin entity was doing his thing. Oh, look at that. Look at this stalking. Ooh. But yeah, had I but known that this was going on, this person shifted in time, because he's a bit older than me. He's like my mum's age. He's my mum. He's my mama. He would just love to, he just wanted to look after kids and have kids and just have a family and just, you know. What was I talking about before? Oh, film and storytelling, yeah. So, that's very interesting. It's like, I don't know. I don't know what to make of it. I mean, I'm just going to do whatever I want anyway, right? But, I just find it so interesting that, so, I know that the world is stuck in a certain kind of paradigm that is not conducive to artists, because the thing to know about artists, okay, for all the non-artists watching this, got to understand that artists, in a very important way, they don't live in the world. They're kind of, we live in our heads, we live in our imaginations, we live in fantasy, in the world of fantasy, a mental, emotional, spiritual fantasy of our own creation or investigation. And that's where you got to be if you want to create. And Mike was all about, he was very mental. He loved to ponder, loved to think about, you know, the idea of conceiving something in the mind and then for that to become reality, for that to become instantiated and to really grasp and kind of to have control and to create and to control, to make manifest, to make, to create, to control, to govern. He's a mental guy. Mental, spiritual, emotional, and physical. Very sensual. Can't take him anywhere. He just touches everything. But yeah, there's this fascinating combination as well of the, you know, the intuitive aspect and the sensing aspect. So it's like, I guess our spectrum is just wide, as I've alluded to in previous videos. Our spectrum is wide, so we're extremely mental and extremely physical as well. It's not like we're just one or the other, or that any person should be one or the other. We are many multifaceted people. Many, many facets, and seemingly paradoxical facets too. I mean, how can someone be so off in the clouds, but then at the same time so embodied and so physical? That's a fascinating thing about this guy. And myself as well, I guess, because I'm pretty mental, but I'm quite mental. Quite insane. Quite. What else? Shifted in time, like parallel. So this pattern thing, right? So as I had reached a point in my fuck, he just pointed, look at that, synchronicity city. As I had reached in my video called MJ synchronicities, understanding reality, or and how we might, I forgot the title, you know what I'm saying, MJ synchronicities and what they may say about the nature of reality, 2020, that's the title. So in that I had come to a tentative sort of ideation that perhaps we're so similar because we're expressing the same pattern in some fundamental pattern, right? Is being expressed. I'm just going to make another video of the same type because I got more things to say. So we're going back to him where he's, you know, he's doing his little shuffle thing. Ch, 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 where I did the ch, ch, ch in the first instance of the almost 7 minute film. 3 7s are 2021. Anyway, so this pattern thing, right? So there are people in history, all throughout history, who are very, very similar. It's like they're all conforming to the same template. Oh God, I love that. Oh, that walk, man, you cannot dream that up. Oh, the confidence. Just prowling around. Takes my breath away. The swagger, the... Oh, stop. He's doing the Christ pose. Incidentally, Christ is one of these people. And of course, Mike identified strongly with Christ. Everyone can see that. And his life story is very similar. And people like Simone Weil, Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, Jim Morrison, this guy, Tom Montauk, this Montauk.net guy is fully a Christ himself. So this Christ type, and that reminds me, like, I once had this dream where I looked at my palms and I could see straight through my palms because each palm had a perfectly circular hole in them, right? I could see straight through and there was no blood or bones or guts or anything hanging out. It was just a clean, straight through, not even cylindrical, but sort of tapered off. So it was very clean. I could just lift up my hand and see straight through to what was outside behind my hand. And both hands, there's another synchronicity just happened. Both hands had this. I can't remember whether my feet had these holes in them too, possibly. But at the time, I don't, you know, and I was recounting this dream to somebody, and they said to me, you had a stigmata dream. And I kind of knew what that was, but I just never put two and two together. Like, that's like a thing of mine. Sometimes I really don't put two and two together, because things are in separate boxes in my brain. But so they said that I had a stigmata dream, and then it sort of made me think, oh, well, that's the Christ analogy is very clear. And what is it about this Christ thing in the world, this Christ person? They're very, very, they're idealistic, they're driven. Well, they're the leader hunter HSP type that I've been exploring, pretty much. You know, the Luke Skywalkers of the world. The freedom fighters, you know, the rebels. I mean, what a rebel Christ was, man. I was listening to Jesus Christ Superstar, the wonderful musical, yesterday, and that's just so banging. That whole soundtrack is just so great. But his ideas are completely revolutionary. Jordan Peterson's all over it. Like, there's a Christ impulse in history, it seems, and there are certain individuals, not many of them, but they reliably exist. They always pop up in history. These Christ people who enact the Christ impulse in the world. And then there are the opposing forces, of course, you know, the what do you call them? The people who arrested him and the corrupt leaders and stuff. And the Judas, you know, the betrayers. And it's like all these roles are so, it's like templates. We're just acting out templates. And that really throws a question mark over free will. I mean, I don't think we have free will to an extent, but only to an extent, to a certain depth, beyond which you just conform to your template, whatever template you happen to have been born into. So this guy and I have the same, we're acting out the same, and all the other people that I mentioned, we're just acting out the Christ impulse, and Jordan Peterson as well, and we feel our values very strongly, and we must live according to our values. We are pretty much uncorruptible, invincible, you might say, as a wise man once said. So, always babbling on about our mission, you know, like R2-D2. He's always babbling on about his mission. We're always on a mission. We're on a mission. I mean, I want to read some of Tom Montauk's writing, because it's very beautiful. Very, very, very interesting writing about this. He doesn't call it the Christ impulse, but that's what he's writing about. And so, and the whole crucifixion thing, I mean, Mike was basically crucified in many people's eyes, and Christ was crucified. And it's like, if it's a template that's being played out, a sort of dialectical, is it the dialectic? Or the Hegelian dialectic, I think, is. And Jung had the same idea as well, that, you know, you can't have good without evil. The two give each other reality. So these people talking about, these utopian people talking about bringing about a utopia. I mean, if a utopia was actually brought about, it was actually instantiated, I don't think it could work. Like, that tension of opposites acting upon one another, you know, the yin and the yang, that symbiotic, that tug of war that goes on,